All right. So in the previous episode, we talked a little bit about the FFI, the foreign function interface in Odin. And so today we're going to be looking at one example of that and take a look at sort of what that entails. We're going to look at both the side where we want to call external code, code that is defined, in some other language. And also how we export things to other languages. We're going to do this through the lens of Erlang interop, so meaning running functions that can be used by Erlang or Elixir in this particular case, and also calling the Erlang functions, the C functions, in order to talk about data and so on. So let's briefly look at sort of what does it mean to interop with Erlang. Well, it means a few things. So if we go to an example file here, Odin NIF, this is a fairly simple, straightforward thing here. We are going to have a few functions here. So we're instructing Erlang, the Erlang platform, to, when this module is loaded, we're going to run init here, which is going to load a NIF. And a NIF is a natively implemented function. And it's going to load this object file here. And that's pretty much it. It's going to then fill in these slots here. So if we look here at Odin, NIFs Odin here, we will see that we have these corresponding functions, right? And so hello here is going to have the shape of, well, basically the shape that a NIF has, generally speaking, and so on. And that is that it takes an environment. This is basically the current state of things in some sense. It takes how many arguments the function actually takes, and it takes just an array of Erlang terms and so on. So, we can see here that nothing here, this here, does not take a value, right? So what does it mean to actually call this, right? If we say Odin NIF, hang on, let's see. What did we call this? We call this Odin NIF, yeah? Ah, hang on. Yeah. This is, of course, what we want to do. We can see we've compiled some files here. Odin NIF. Dot hello is the function we were looking at, and that gives us a string that is actually generated from Odin. So if we look at this here, we can actually see make string here, enif make string in the environment, this string here, and then set the encoding for that string, and so on. And there's nothing super crazy going on here. If we look at the other alternatives, we can see actually that they take arguments. So if we go back briefly here, we will see that hello binary takes a count. And if we go to the actual NIF in question, we can see here that we are going to be checking the arguments here. So we want to get one argument. Right, we're gonna take out argv0 here, and fill in int value here with that. And if we couldn't get an int, right, we are going to be returning bad arg here, right? So let's look briefly at how that works. So if I say Odin NIF hello binary, this is our function name, right? And I say, let's say 42 here, we get 42 O's. If I were to instead say, send, let's say, have a binary here, 42, we would get an argument error. And there's nothing super strange about this. In practice, you might actually want to return an error tuple in certain cases and so on, but that is a little bit out of the scope of what we're doing here. And here we can actually see that Odin is the thing that is allocating initially here. We're making a slice of bytes that is int value long, right? We've we passed this point, so we know that we have read into int value the actual value that this had in our environment, right? And here we're setting every value in those bytes to 0, and that's really it, right? Initially, there will be 0 bytes, and yeah, we would just want to fill them in with O's and so on. And that's really just because, well, this is just a simple way of, you know, showing this kind of thing. And so here we're actually creating an Erlif binary, which can be, basically, it's just a string in reality. So we saw enif make string here. That is actually a character list in Erlang. So a binary would be much more akin to what we kind of expect a string to be in many languages, and so on. So here we have enif make binary. We actually say, hey, here's the actual binary structure and so on. Here's the data, the size of it, and so on and so forth. And importantly, a binary can be any basically sequence of bytes, right? It just so happens when it's a printable binary, we actually just sort of print it to the screen and so on. If you want to look at the third simple example, we can have this hello tuple here. And if we say tag and count here, we can, let's try it out, right? So Odin if hello tuple, tag hello, I suppose. Let's see. Right. And this is now generating a nested object. So we can see here that this is a tuple. And if you're confused here about the colon hello, this is really just a way of saying we have an atomic symbol, right? This is an atom. So these are symbols, they are not decomposable. So they're not strings or binaries or anything interesting like this. They are just, under the hood, they are just values that are integers, basically. But there is an internment table called the atom table that basically says this symbol corresponds to this integer. And what we can do behind the scenes, or what Erlang does rather, is that it basically compares these incredibly efficiently, right? Because they are just integers. We can just compare integers instead of comparing actual kind of decomposable symbols, right? So if I have, for example, let's say I say hello here, this is exactly the same hello as the previous one because it has the same entry in the atom table, right? But if I say hello two, this is technically a different thing, and they are not comparable in the sense that we can compare age in one and age in the other, E, and so on and so forth. We cannot decompose these, hence they are called atoms, right? Of course we can split an atom, but yeah. So yeah, this is now creating a tuple, which is a structure like this. First element, second element. Technically we can have tuples also that are as follows. So we can have 1, 2 and 3 and 4 and so on, but this is a two element tuple which is structured like this, right? So we can see here that we have a two element tuple with hello 2 and then a list of things here, right? And yeah, so that's what we have here, and that's how we generate that, is a similar process where we create different terms, right? So we're going to pull set our context to default context, and so on. The reason we have to do this is because this is a C function. It's not part of the Odin calling convention, and so it doesn't have a context. So we have to set one in our scope. And so term argument here is going to be pulling out this first argument, and then it's going to say, pull this out as a integer, right? And then it's going to make a slice of NIF terms here. We want to do. We're going to create an atom. Right. Yes, an atom with just the value Odin, right? And then we make a list. And so on from an array. This is the array that we made up here, the terms, and with this count here, right, the list size. Hence, when we actually call this, we get, for example, we could say 4 here, we get 4 Odins, right? And so that's the basic structure. And what Erlang actually expects from us is the following, a table of NIF functions. right? With a name, an arity, a function pointer, and flags. And it expects also this nif init function here to be callable and exported, which tells us basically what am I using? What VM am I actually in? What's the name of the module? And what's the minimum Erlang runtime system version that I can run with? And also they have this control here for basically certain structures, right? A certain structure here, and so on. And here's the amount of functions we export and so on and so forth, right? So basically this is what it's expected of us, basically when we have a module like this. And in order to actually do these things, of course, we have to interface with Erlang, right? So we've seen the side where we actually provide these functions, but let's look briefly at sort of what am I using to write these things? Because as you may have noticed, we actually have this Erldin library here that actually, it seems to do a lot of work, right? And it is really not that much work though, right? So if we go to Erlang utilities here, we're gonna see here that we have our basic functions here for making these types of objects that exist in Erlang, right? And they aren't actually, they're a fairly limited set actually. And of course, this is not complete, but it is what's needed for the actual things in this repo. And I'm going to share this repo so that people can see, you know, what exists in there. There is a slots implementation, meaning a bucket of pointers basically that you can set and so on for efficiency's sake and so on. So that can be interesting to look at. There's also a C version and a Zig version of everything. So people can compare and so on. And so the actual utility side of this comes down to just a few key things. So you have the basic FFI definitions here for just describing what C functions exist, right? And then you have types that actually underline everything, right? So for example, what is an env? Well, it's a raw pointer. We don't care what it is. It's an opaque type to us. The env is passed to us from Erlang and we use the env with our functions. That's really it. So it's a handle. You can view this as a handle, right? This pattern is extremely common, extremely powerful. So just view this as a handle. Then we have a term, which is yet another type of handle. So a term here is also, it's just a number representing some kind of value in our environment, if you think about it like this, right? So that's what a term is. And at the core of it, it's really just making sense out of the expected interface that is the question, right? Looking at the include files and so on and saying, here's the thing that I need to actually do, right? And so a load function, a reload function, upgrade function, unload function, etc. What is a NIF func? Well, describe these, you know, as you can in types, right? And then make your interface sort of mirror these things, right? So where we have an env, we have an env. We have a pointer to an env here even. Where we have a term here, and so on. And so this is going to, generally speaking, be how you do stuff. And it's really not that difficult. I think you will find when you sit down and you try to interrupt with a language, it's usually not that complicated, right? And of course, I've heard some, you know, horror stories about certain languages, certainly JNI or the Java native interface or whatever it might be. I've heard some terrible stories about, right? But generally speaking, you'll probably find that it's not really that difficult. You can write Odin code to run in many different places via FFI. And so, yeah, this was just a, I wanted to briefly show an actual example of this. And like I said, I'm going to be posting the repo URL for this repo so that people can play around with it and sort of see what's what, if someone's interested in Erlang and Elixir and so on. By the way, when I say Erlang in this video, of course, I mean also Elixir, because Elixir is just a set of libraries on top of Erlang, really. So everything I've said that applies to Erlang also applies to Elixir. It's just that we are obviously integrating with the Erlang native interface and so on here, right? So, yeah, That's it for this video. We can look in the future maybe at interoperating with other languages to see sort of how that works out and so on. Haskell would be an interesting idea. We might also try to have a demonstrative example of just sort of interoperating with a C library or something and pulling that into Odin and so on. We could look deeper into the SQLite example, for example, or making PDFs with, I don't remember what the library is called, but it's a very common C library, and so on. Yeah, that's it for today. I hope that this was useful, but more than anything, I hope it was kind of, let's say, inspirational for you to see that most of this stuff is not really that complicated. You can sit down and actually just get going, really. It's really not that problematic to sit down and write some Odin code that runs somewhere else in the long run. But yeah, okay. If you like the video, like it. If you want more content about Odin and so on, please subscribe. Have a nice day and ciao.